I'd like to offer some suggestions and ideas on how to disseminate and implement evidence-based dentistry in practice. I'd like to start with challenges with dissemination and implementing evidence-based dentistry. These include challenges amongst colleagues in academia and, of course, with patient education. Some examples of statements overheard in some continuing education courses are things like, "We treat patients, not statistics." "That EBD stuff is for those in academia." And mentioned in previous conference, "Why do we need guidelines?" Is EBD being used as a buzzword? Now, there are also challenges teaching EBD to students. Probably one of the most important challenges is how to educate and ultimately provide evidence-based care to patients. This is especially important when they ask questions and in their minds when they provide their version of evidence with regards to, for example, oil pulling or frequency or taking radiographs or root canals causing cancer and more recently flossing. Now, if we take a step back to the challenges faced among colleagues, patients, and in academia, we cannot overlook that there is still a broader issue. That broader issue being the need for more evidence-based reviews, more evidence-based literature, systematic reviews, and ways to sift through the myriad of literature that is so ubiquitous. These topics are covered by my friends and colleagues in the EBD series online. Let me provide a blueprint of some ideas to help overcome these challenges and therefore provide possibly better evidence-based oral health care for your patient. We'll discuss team training, communicating patient care, sifting through some of the junk science, and having readily available guidelines already published. We'll discuss some strategies on how to implement in practice, because remember, making an informed and educated decision with your patient is ultimately key in practice. And then we'll touch upon discussing the science among colleagues. So let's dive into team training. Here's a tip on how to implement EBD with your staff. In your practice, have your team trained and on board with your treatment philosophy with regards to EBD. Educate staff on EBD principles. Train staff on how to use ADA's EBD website, such as the systematic reviews and searching clinical guidelines. Communicate evidence and research to patients. Have access to clinical guidelines chairside, and also have printouts of clinical reviews that are common to your patient. Now, your team can also pick one topic a month to bring maybe to a monthly meeting, such as flossing, sealants, oil pulling, dental implants, or even relearn some of the EBD clinical guidelines or plain language summaries that may already be published. You can also pose a topic to your staff to research. Now, place this topic for staff to read once a week, or you can discuss it during a brief morning meeting. And then remember to catalog these articles and catalog any of the feedback that you get, not only from your team, but maybe also from your patients. As a private practitioner, these are some challenges you may face amongst colleagues and with patients. Similar to the food industry's from farm to table concept, I often seek from laboratory to mouth. So what exactly does the appraised research say? What are some of the best ways to treat patients? What does the sign say about antibiotic prophylaxis, routine use of antibiotics? What does the sign say about opioids as used for post-endodontic procedures or post-surgery? What does the sign say about adjunctive laser therapy for initial stage periotherapy? What about the use for sealants, use of SDF or silver diamine fluoride? What does the sign say about pulp capping with regards to pulpotomy or stainless steel crowns? Now, when I hear from patients, there's the usual, "Well, I read this on the internet," or "Do I really have to have sealants? I don't have to take x-rays. My teeth don't hurt." So to answer these questions, I would suggest keeping some articles handy chairside with you, articles pertaining to those topics that were just mentioned. You could bookmark some pages you may find relevant from Cochrane, PubMed, the ADA EBD website. Again, keep some of these handy for the plain language summaries that your patient may want to take with them if they choose. So these could be found on the ADA's EBD website. So remember, when speaking to colleagues, here's some suggestions to disseminate an appraised scientific guideline or article. You could speak at your local district dental society. You could speak at a hygiene society. You could form a study club. Or with proper permission, you can even write a newsletter article. As social media continues to be a major source of where we get our information, using various platforms can aid not only your colleagues, but also your patients. For example, if they like your Facebook page, or if they follow you on Twitter or Instagram. The use of hashtags can be beneficial as well. For example, hashtag EBD champs. You can also form a study club with your friends, include your specialist friends. You can also pick up the phone and start discussions. You can also join or form a Facebook group, a LinkedIn group. Now, as you champion evidence-based care with your colleagues, team, and most importantly, your patients, keep these things in mind. You want to educate and inform your team and patients when making treatment decisions, disseminate knowledge amongst practice team, and also allow for professional discussion and debate. I hope these suggestions and strategies mentioned will offer you a starting point in disseminating and implementing EBD in practice. Remember that evidence-based dentistry improves patient care by integrating three important aspects of clinical practice: a dentist's expertise, a patient's needs and preferences, and the best available scientific evidence. For more EBD resources, visit ebd.ada.org.